Good evening and good welcome. I'm honored to have the right to present Professor Éric Toussaint to you. Professor Toussaint has been a senior lecturer at University of Liege, president of the Committee for Abolition of the Third World Debt, member of the International Council of the World Social Forum, and although he has a number of other functions, I will just briefly mention, because he's probably well known to you, that he was also a member of the CAIC committee, which managed to help Ecuador in 2007 to get rid of part of its public debt. Today we're here to present his book, The Debt Crisis from Europe to Where. By the way, the book is available online. Professor Toussaint also has a few copies with him. If you're interested, you can later reach him. I will not speak long in this introduction. Just like to say that the book is a collection of mainly his essays, but there are also other authors: Damien Millet, Daniel Munevar, Renaud Vivien, and of course, Éric Toussaint. The book is a series of interviews which gives you an overview of three broad areas. First of all, it's about the European capitalism in crisis. Secondly, in the second part, it's the global context. And in the third part, it's about resistance and alternatives. In the book, you can see an excellent account of the crisis, of the chronology of the crisis, and his thoughts as to how to deal with it. In the first part, it's the usual suspect, so to speak: Greece, Ireland, Portugal, even Croatia, because he gave an interview a while ago for Croatian media. It's about illegitimacy of public debt and why we need to think of it, at least part of it, as illegitimate. It's about the example of Ecuador and how it got rid of part of his debt. The second part focuses on the global financial architecture, the way it is usually called, and the balance of power in the world that then gives the most economically powerful nations also the largest share of the vote in international financial organizations such as the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. It's about United States and President Obama and his failure to deal with mainly the financial causes of the global crisis. In the third part, there are things about what he calls Audit, Action, Abolition, AAA, in referral basically to the credit rating agency's AAA rating. So basically, he wants to say these things are important, not the rating agencies. And of course, a sketch of policies to retain the viability of the public sector. But I do believe that Professor Toussaint is the first name here at this festival to be called upon to discuss the questions of public debt and how to deal with it, how to be able to audit the public debt and to pronounce some of it, at least, as illegitimate. So it's a rights-based approach to public debt, and it would be very interesting to hear from you how you see the moves, the next steps in order to get rid of it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Very glad to be with you on this end of this afternoon. But Vladimir, maybe if you allow me, you told me that when we prepared this talk, you told me that the question of the private debt of the people is also a major thing. So maybe I will say something at the beginning on that.
Exactly.
Because it's clear that all the governmental discourse, the message given by the dominant medias, the European Central Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and the European Commission, and also the bankers, the main focus on which they want to attract our attention is the problem of the sovereign debt. The sovereign debt is the debt of the state, I would say. That's not all the public debt, but that's a major part of the public debt. The public debt is the debt contracted by states, etc., and the sovereign debt is the debt, the part of the public debt due to creditors by the state, okay? And you have the private debt. In reality, the major problem is not the public or sovereign debt, but the private debt. And the major problem for us is the debt of the banks. So when we think about banks, we think about private institutions who are creditors, but banks are also debtors, and the debt of the banks is very huge. In general, the private debt of the financial institution, mainly banks, is three times the sovereign or public debt. Okay? So the debt of the financial institution is a major problem, and the sovereign debt in a large part of our countries is inherited by the transfer or socialization of private debt, the debt of the banks, transferred or transformed into sovereign debt. How does it occur? It occurs through the bailout of the banks. And I think Croatia is part, have known this type of experience, the bailout of banks in Croatia generated sovereign debt. The major cases in Western countries, the USA, but I would say at the level of the proportion that Ireland, Iceland, Spain, my country, Belgium, the Netherlands, Germany, the bailout in Germany were very huge, bailout of the banks, private banks, in the UK also. So in the last 5 years, in several countries, the increase of the sovereign debt was from 20% at least to 50 or 60% increase of the sovereign debt directly provoked by the bailout of the private debt of the private banks. Okay? It's a very important thing. Another part of the private debt is the family debt. The families indebted, for instance, to buy housing, to buy real estate. For instance, in Ireland, in the UK, in USA, in Spain, also in the Netherlands, but we have the problem in Hungary and in several, I don't know the importance of that in Croatia, but several Eastern or Central countries of Europe have huge problem of housing or real estate debt. And a big problem is that banks gave money to the people for buying houses in or in relation directly with Swiss francs. So you have debt in reality related, indexed to the Swiss francs who gain value in the last 5 years. And so we have also to tackle the problem of the, I would say, the debt of the families which are affected twice or three times by the crisis. Families who in Spain who lost their job, they are not able to pay back the debt they incurred to buy houses, and they are expulsed from the houses by the banks. In Spain, it's particularly catastrophic and scandalous, because in Spain, when a family cannot pay back the debt for the housing, they are expelled from the flat or from the house, and the banks will discount from the debt the value at the market value of the flat or the house. But if you have a bubble which exploded in real estate, the price went down, okay? And so the value of the houses is very low. So the family is expelled from the houses, they have no job, they have no roof, but they have a debt. And it could be a huge amount of debt to the bank. And at that level, it's not a main item in the book, but for me, it's a very major thing and a major challenge in several countries for the social movement to struggle against the illegitimate debt of the families and to succeed in protecting the families and to solving their problem with a cancellation of this illegitimate debt. In the United States, you have more than 20,000 legal procedures against banks for fraudulent loans, fraudulent or fraudulent loans to families. And there are negotiation between the US justice and the state, for instance, the state of New York and Bank of America, Citigroup, and other banks. And it's a very huge problem. And I mentioned 1 hour ago in the previous panel also the debt of the students. In the US, the debt of the students is the amount is a trillion. A trillion is 12 zeros. Okay, a trillion dollars debt. If you compare the amount of the student debt only in the USA, is higher than the addition of the public external debt of all Latin America and all Sub-Saharan Africa. Together, these two regions have a debt lower than the debt of the student in the US. And so in the US, you have students, because of the crisis, they have no job and they have a debt. In general, the promedia debt of the student in the US is $15,000 to $20,000. But you have students who have a debt of $40,000, $60,000, $80,000. So if the movement Occupy, they had a discussion and they launched a movement whose name is Strike the Debt, to organize the resistance to the payment of the student debt, of the real estate debt, of the families, etc. Okay, now the public debt, the sovereign debt. So,
I could just ask you a small question here, because the debt is pressing on the households from one side due to credits having been taken for houses, for cars, and so on, which is the case also in Croatia, particularly pressing because of the denomination of these credits into Swiss franc. So the NGO Franak sued not just the business banks, but also Croatian National Bank, which took the whole thing to the new level. So maybe just a brief comment on that, whether you would any real life examples from elsewhere which could help us here, not just in Croatia. The problem is all over the place in Southeastern Europe. Secondly, as regards the private debt, we talked earlier, it's the transfer of debt by private banks to the public sector. We had the bailouts and other agreements. How debt can be stopped? You mentioned the case of Dexia in Belgium. So these, when these mechanisms unfold, they could be very hard to bear on the households. How can we stop that?
So in the major experience now is in the US. So I say people are suing their banks to succeed a sentence of a tribunal, of a court, to declare null and avoid, so to cancel the debt, to say this debt is illegal and the banks cannot anymore ask for repayment of that debt. It's a huge question in USA, and in Europe you have no media speaking about all the struggles on that question. And in the Obama policy, it's an important question, because the banks are so unpopular now in the US that he should try to give the impression that he is asking the banks to find a solution to reduce the amount of the household debt for real estate, and or to pay fees to the state and to cancel debt, and to abandon the process of foreclosure. This is to say expulsion of the family from the houses. Because in the US, we don't have the exact figure, but I would say more than 5 million families were expelled from the houses since 2007. In Spain, now that's 500,000 families expelled from the houses. I say it's really a massive question, and a struggle on that question is very important. So when you told me that in Croatia an NGO sued the banks and the state, I think it's a very good initiative. On the sovereign debt, what we have done in my country as organization, so the Committee for the Abolition of Third World Debt, as we are an international network, but our organization in Belgium, we have sued the state of Belgium for giving a guarantee to one of the major banks, Dexia Bank, a guarantee of, now it's 50 billion euros. 50 billion euros is 15% of the gross domestic product, annual gross domestic product of Belgium. And so we are suing the state. Yesterday when I was here, I received the answer of the state. They are, so I have a document of 45 pages. The states against CADTM in front of the state council. So we are in confrontation, and there is a big campaign in the dominant medias in Belgium against us, trying to responsibilize, to make us responsible of what could happen with this bank if she, if the bank went bankrupt. She went, she was bailed out three times since in 5 years, 2008, 2011 and 2012. And the government injected in this bank something like 10 billion euros, but gave further a guarantee on 50 billion euros. A guarantee, what does it mean? If the bank is not capable to pay its creditors, the state will pay for in place of the bank. So we sued the, frankly, we sued the state with no illusion of having a victory against the state on this question. We know how the justice is organized in our country, but it helped us to make, to sensibilize the public opinion. And that's the reason why now the state, the government, and the banks, with dominant medias, are trying to diabolize the CADTM, our organization. But we have some good public support, and we are struggling. And another example, which is, in this case, it's a victory. Several French municipalities decided in the last 2 years to suspend the payment to some banks and to sue the banks for, I don't know the word in English, if somebody could help me to translate from French, to sue the bank for escroquerie. Escroquerie en bande organisée. Escroquerie is maybe robbery, or when you, when somebody is, I don't know how to translate, but it's a crime. It's a so municipality sued for extortion. It's something like that, yes. Something like that, yes.
Something very bad, probably.
It's very interesting. Justice in France gave reason to these municipalities. They say, you are right to suspend the payment. And these, in some cases, some tribunals say the debt to these banks is illegal because it's an extortion. Okay? So now we have cases in Western countries of public authorities which decided to suspend unilaterally the payment of a debt, and they have gained. Okay? The bank which was sued is Dexia, because Dexia is a Belgian and French bank, and also Royal Bank of Scotland, which gave some loans to municipalities in France, and also Deutsche Bank, Credit Suisse, and other big and major private bank. Okay, the case in the, and I am involved in this question of municipalities. At CADTM, with the association Attac, we organize and we are training municipal councils, we are training them to explain how they can sue banks. We are submitting to municipal council motion to be submitted to the votes, saying that we will sue the banks, etc. And we gain some space on that question in the last 2 years. And so the experience in which I have been personally directly involved is the case of Ecuador. Ecuador, in the year 2006, the people of Ecuador elected a new president, Rafael Correa. He is still now president. He was re-elected 6 months ago with 57% of the vote. But he was first elected in December 2006. And in his campaign as candidate for the presidency, he promised to the people, if you elect me as president, I take the compromise to find a solution to stop the payment of the illegitimate public debt. I explained that in if you want to see the documental Debtocracy, which was presented here last year by the Chris Harris and Catherine, who made this documental, very important, Debtocracy. You can find this documental on several websites, and you can use it free of charge. In this documental, we explain how our experience with Ecuador. Just to summarize, the decision of Correa was very important because he was elected promising to find a solution. His first initiative after being elected was on the question of a new constitution. He struggled to convince the people to vote through a referendum to elect a new constituent assembly, to elaborate a project of new constitution with the participation of the civil society. And after this process, the new project of the constitution was submitted to a general votation. So it was a very democratic process of democratization of the state. And they introduced in the new constitution very important things on the debt. And we were part of the process, and the Constituent Assembly invite us as commission in charge of auditing the public debt of the country, we were inviting by the deputies of the Constituent Assembly to make proposal to change the constitution on the question of the debt. But let me tell you that after this battle on the question of the constitution and the referendum, the next battle, one little one, was to expulse the permanent representative of the World Bank in the country. He expelled this person as a non grata person because this person, as representative of the World Bank, faire du chantage, blackmailed the government in 2005. Okay, he expelled the World Bank. He also tells the IMF, please, you have to go out of the central bank, try to find a house, and you have to pay a rent for that. We will not offer you rooms inside the central bank. We are part of the IMF, but... So, since the beginning, he was questioning the legitimacy of this institution. And in July 2007, he took a decree, presidential decree, creating an audit commission. There were 12 citizens of Ecuador, representative of social movement, 4 foreigners, and I was one of the 6 foreigners, and I was one of the 6 as experts on that, and 5 organs of the state, the Commission, Anti-Corruption Commission, the Ministry of Justice, the Ministry of Finances, and la Cour des Comptes, the General Accounting Office, I don't know in Croatia how you name it. In the US is General Accounting Office. They were part of the commission. We worked 14 months. Our mission was to analyze all the public debts from 76 to 2006, 30 years of indebtedness. So we worked very hard during 14 months, and we, during this experience, we present 3 times to the government and the president our partial results and conclusion. At the end, we redact a common document, of less than something like 190 pages, and we redact also our recommendation to the government. The government made public our analysis, public on internet, and make a public conferences to tell the people what were our conclusion. And during this conference, in November 2008, the government say we will suspend unilaterally the payment of the debt to the banks, to the private banks, for an amount of 3,000 million, $3 billion in bonds. It was very important because it was a sovereign, unilateral decision based on an audit, but a very abnormal or extraordinary audit, because with the participation of the citizenship, and in a situation in which Ecuador has money, because Ecuador exports oil. The price of oil is more than $100 a barrel. And so Ecuador has money to pay back the debt. But Ecuador say, if the debt is illegitimate, we decided to suspend the payment because we want to use the money we have to satisfy human rights, to increase expenses in education, in public health, in creation of jobs, in infrastructure, etc. So it was a scandal. The Financial Times made several editorials, you know, this daily paper printed in Britain, and with the Wall Street Journal, that the two main daily papers, international financial daily papers. And the Financial Times wrote, it's incredible, a government, they have money, and they use ethical, moral, and some legal argument, but not related to commercial rights, but to human rights, to suspend the payment. It's crazy, but they do that. They did that, and I would say they used the contradiction between the bankers. What they said, what they did. Correa asked one of the major bank, private bank, international bank, Banque Lazare, which is an investment bank. You have no offices of Lazare because they are not interested here. They are something like a little Goldman Sachs, I would say.
You don't have need to have offices here in order to provide people with credit.
And yes, because they are not interested in that. There are an oak inside the ocean of oaks of bankers, okay? So Correa asked this bank to buy back the bonds, which value with the suspension of payment went down to 20% of the facial value. So Lazare bought the bonds at 20% of the value, 80% discount, okay? I finish. After 3 months, having gathered more than 40% of the bonds, Ecuador made an official proposal to the bankers, which still did not sell the bonds to the Lazare. And the official proposal of the Ecuador was to say, we will buy the bonds at 35% of the value. So at the end of the process, the state bought 91% of the bonds at a discount price from 65 to 80% discount. And the bonds, when the bonds were 2012 and 2030 bonds, so they also stopped the payment of the interest because they bought the bonds. They don't exist anymore. I think it's a very interesting initiative because it shows that a little country could confront the creditors against all the normal rules and imposed a change on the correlation of forces to the creditors.
Don't be deceived by the title of the organization. The third world is much closer than it used to be. I'd like to open floor for your questions. You can address questions in relation to that or to other part of other things in this book. We might also bring the things back to Europe, please. Ahead.
I'm coming from Slovenia, and our government decided that we will solve our banking system with the bad bank, so bad decision with the name of bad bank, so the transfer of these toxic credits to the government. We brought in public the idea of bad bank for private debt of households. So what do you think about that idea? So that the government would protect the private bank,
will protect
the debt of households, that it will guarantee for it.
What I think is that the debt which if you are speaking about household, it depends on the case, but in the US, you have, as I mentioned, clearly illegal debt. So it should be canceled. So the banker should erase in the balance sheet the value of the loans to these families. And as I told you, there is few information about that in Europe, but it happened in the US now. Big banks like both Bank of America, Citigroup, are forced to erase in their books of account the loans to a part of the population. It's marginal at the level of the total volume, but so that my proposal in the case in the if banks sold to the people through contracts which abuse the confidence of the household of the debtor, this debt should be cancelled. The other question, the bailout of private banks. For me, the solution is the expropriation, socialization of private banks without compensation to the stakeholders, and include, if the socialization needs expenses, because a lot of private banks have a huge amount of debt. When you expropriate them, you expropriate also, you responsabilize as state for the debt of these banks to other creditors. So you have to find a solution. And the solution is also, I would say, to impose to the stakeholders participation to the bailout of the bank. But I would say they will not only lose the value of the stake as stakeholder, but they have to pay assainir une banque, to clean the bank, to make this bank capable to really function as a public bank. It's clear that it is a very radical challenge. I know that if we want to do that, we should build a very powerful movement, because the solution to the debt question, to the sovereign debt question, and to the private debt question, the amount are so huge, you cannot find little solution. It's one part supposed, one part of the solution is cancellation of the illegitimate part of the sovereign debt through restructuration, through repudiation, etc. It's one part. And the other part is socialization of the financial private sector. That's two radical things which should be complemented by other also structural measures, like control of movement of capitals, other taxation and fiscal policies, etc. So I would say it's an overall program to solve the question of the debt. I have no illusion. When as animator or writer on the question of the debt, I never thought that you could solve the problem of the debt apart from the rest of the problem. You should solve the problem of the debt, but you cannot solve the problem of the society and of the debt without taking other complementary structural measures, which are very important.
Yes.
With the socialization of the banks, do you mean nationalization of the banks?
Socialization is something, I would say, why we use socialization? We are several writers and of the organization to speak about socialization, because we want that citizenship be part of the control of the banks. So we are not in favor which exists before, state bank only controlled by the government. We want a control of the citizenship. We want also a participation of the employees of the bank, which are knowing the problem of the bank, internal problem. So that's the reason why we say socialization. But to socialize, you have to expropriate. Okay, you have to transfer from somebody who is the owner, the private owner, you have to transform the bank as a common good, I would say, as a common, okay?
Could you wait for a mic, please?
Yes, the nation state should do that, yes. The Croatian state, the Belgian state, the Portuguese state, the Spanish state, and including being part of the European Union. You know, since 5 years, several banks have been nationalized by the states. Royal Bank of Scotland in the UK, other banks in the UK. In Belgium, Dexia Bank is 100% of the state now, since 2 years. But they nationalized these banks, transferring the cost to the public, and with the motivation is they will clean the bank, and after that they will privatize another time the bank. When the bank will be cleaned, they will sell it And we are totally opposed to that. We are for the transformation of the financial sector to a public service, to a public utility. The utility to give loans, to receive the money of the people who want to deposit the money, and to secure this money, and to give to the society the guarantee that the money will be used, will be invested for the common interest of the population. That's the idea.
We have a question over there.
Hi. My question is related to the case of Ecuador that you presented. I was wondering if you could comment or explain a little bit what happens after a state unilaterally refuses to repay part of its debt. It pisses off the international creditors. What happens to its access to international finance after that, or how does it get capital?
Maybe just a slight addition. Ecuador is a very interesting example, but Slovenia, as part of a Eurozone, could be an even closer to us. So maybe you could take into account these different institutional arrangements, because Ecuador is elsewhere, obviously. Unfortunately, the last question, because we will then probably not have any more time.
Okay, Ecuador has not anymore now access to the financial markets. Argentina, which suspended the payment in 2001 until 2005, has no access to the financial markets. But does it create a real problem for Argentina or Ecuador? I don't think so. In this case, analyzing the we have no time to explain how they found finances through another type of policy, but you can at least increase your revenues with the taxation of the rich, for instance, with the taxation of the exporters and the multinational who are working or exploiting your natural resources, that's the case of Ecuador, Argentina, and other countries. And you can find some other partners to finance. In the case of Ecuador, China is financing different projects. And in several Latin American countries also. I would say the case which is more in relation with Europe is Iceland. Iceland, you know, in 2008 there was a general bankruptcy of the private banks, and the UK and the Netherlands decided to compensate the resident who lost money with the bankruptcy. And after that, UK and the Netherlands asked Iceland to compensate the UK and the Netherlands for 3.5 billion euros. And Iceland entered in a negotiation, but the people were, and the government tried to find an agreement with UK and the Netherlands. The people were opposed. Though a referendum was convoked through a democratic process, an initiative of the population, of the citizenship, and people vote 90% against the agreement with UK and the Netherlands. So Iceland was not paying UK and the Netherlands. There was another negotiation And another time the government reached an agreement with UK and the Netherlands, and the population also protest. A new referendum was organized, and 62% of the population voted against the compensation. So, what happened? Iceland did not compensate the UK and the Netherlands with public money. They controlled totally the movement of capitals, so they blocked the capital inside the country, and it was fully successful. And they began a process of liquidation of the assets of the failed, bankrupt private banks. And now they are using the assets in the liquidation process to begin to compensate the UK and the Netherlands, but with the private money of the banks, with the money of the banks. What is also important, interesting, it's that the UK, when Iceland suspended the payment, the UK considered Iceland as a terrorist country. And they put, but that's real what I am telling you, they put Iceland in the same list as Al-Qaeda. And they froze all the money owned by Iceland in the UK, telling that it's terrorist money, it is frozen. It is frozen. And UK went to a court, ALA court, which is the court, the tribunal for Norway, Liechtenstein, Switzerland, and Iceland. And 3 months ago, the sentence of the court gave totally reason to Iceland against UK and the Netherlands. So, what is the lesson for me? That in this case also, which is different, you can say Slovenia is part of the Eurozone, Iceland has its own money, is not part of the Eurozone and not part of the European Union. But it's the case of a country who decided unilaterally to suspend the payment and confront the creditors. And UK is some powerful creditor. The Netherlands, in some way, also. And they gain. And the last element to say, we have not time to analyze what happened with Cyprus. But one thing in the Cyprus case, we have the proof now that a country inside the Eurozone could decide to control, to impose a control on the movement of capital. Till now, everybody was saying it's totally impossible for a member of the Eurozone to control the movement of capital. Now, because it was the interest of the European Commission to stop the possibility of Russian, Ukrainian oligarch, and also some UK funds, and the UK is not part of the Eurozone, because of the interest of the Eurozone most powerful members, they decide that Cyprus have to impose a control of movement of capital. But for us, it's clear that the reason of this, the creditors, is not our reason. But now we have, I would say, the proof that it is possible. If Cyprus did that, why Greece, why other countries could not control movement of capital to protect themselves in front of the risk of a massive evasion of capital. So in analyzing as conclusion, analyzing the five last years, we have not real full victories, but we have some sources of inspiration which show that when you disobey as government under the pressure of the population in Iceland or with the support of the population in Ecuador, you could impose to the creditors a renegotiation, a restructuration, a cancellation, important reduction of the debt. So we have to divulgate these experiences and to tell the people, look, there is an alternative. The people who are saying there is no alternative are wrong. There is some alternative, and we have to use this experience, implementing them to our national condition. And it's clear that Iceland is not Croatia, but we can, and Ecuador is not Croatia, but Croatian people could find some inspiration in what Ecuador, Iceland has done in the last 5 years.
Thank you very much for this very important talk.